I'm Brian, which I'll introduce you in a second. My name is Elise Hatton. I think most of you in the room know who I am. And it is my pleasure to welcome you here to the Smart Hub today. Now, as you know, Rockhampton Regional Council is very committed to supporting local entrepreneurs and business owners. And one of the ways in which we demonstrate the support is by hosting these local lunch and learns. Hey, Sonia. Is by hosting these local lunch and learns. And we get phenomenal people who have specialist knowledge to come along and do what I would hope is a knowledge transfer. And my hope with these lunch and learns is always that you would take away one thing that you could implement, or one thing that you could change or alter your thinking, or one thing that will kind of move the needle in your life or in your business. And today is no different. So we have Brian. He is incredible. Brian Bartlett. I'd like to read his bio to you, and through the bio you'll really realize he's a wealth of knowledge. So Brian is a communications technician with a long history of working in regional, rural, and remote areas of Australia, where innovation and implementing new technology was a daily requirement. It's interesting, when you're out in the bush and you have a problem, you have no other opportunity but to innovate. You have to innovate. He has specialized in wireless communication for most of his life, and he has a strong interest in using low-cost new technologies to benefit all, which includes being a keen ambassador for the bicycle. I like that. Brian has been a member of the Alternative Technologies Association for 25 years and is a volunteer teacher at the Rockhampton Regional Library Technology Centre. His talk today focuses on how wireless technologies are now leveraging amongst almost everything we do, and more importantly, how it is changing the way we interact and behave towards each other. What is missing is some long-term thinking that will serve us well into the future. This is why we need to understand what it is to be human, where we have come from, and how to make sure we embrace change with knowledge and purpose. So I'd like to introduce Brian to you, and he'll tell the rest of his story. He also said that he's a very impulsive person, so I'm hoping that you'll be a bit impulsive today as well, and ask some questions and interact with Brian. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everybody, for turning up today. I have to admit that when I was invited to participate and take a course in public speaking, that I had a lot to learn. And so I went off and I used some wireless communication, and I travelled the world, and I went to Stanford University and listened to a person, an expert on public speaking, and then I went to Yale University and listened to some people who had some interesting things to say there. And I also watched some TED Talks. Now, everyone is familiar with TED Talks, technology, entertainment, design. They're commonplace these days. Usually, you can watch them on a computer or iPad, or if you're choosing to watch them anywhere wirelessly, you could be sitting under a tree anywhere and watch them. So, these days, I like to connect the real world with wireless communications. And what that means is, for example, when the sun rises in the morning, we are wirelessly warned from 150 million kilometers away. There are no wires between us and the sun. And there's a big wheel, and we are one of the arms on that wheel that goes around the sun. And we've been doing that for a very long time. And because of that wireless connection we have with something which is really a non-conscious object, but we, the conscious beings, the human race, have pretty much evolved because of that wireless transmission from the sun. So wireless has been around for a long time. Then, of course, as humans developed, we started to speak. And wirelessly, we talked to each other. We had conversations. We used voice and music and even art, which is drawings, and by looking at them we could see wirelessly that these images and these noises and these sounds and these voices and language developed to help us communicate with each other and to make the world, hopefully, a more interesting and better place. Now, at the end of the day, we are no different to what we were a few hundred thousand years ago. We still are using voice to communicate with each other, whether it be over a communications network, like I did, I went around the world, but listened to someone speaking wirelessly, to a microphone, to a recording, to teach basically how to do certain things. And we do this every day. We learn by watching. We learn by wireless communications in every inch of the way. So it is a very big wheel, and we are on this wheel. And travelling through space at a very fast speed. And we'll never be in the same place again as we are today. We'll be somewhere else. We'll never come back here. What does this mean for us? At the end of the day, we have to make the most of the opportunity we've been given to experience the universe as we know it. And we do that by communicating with each other. So what I've done is I've put together, if you like, a talk, not really a presentation, of some really amazing things that have happened, partly in my life, but also just generally in the world. So a part of that is numbers. There are, and I have a little bit here about from some of the great philosophers. For example, throughout history, various numbers have had special meanings ascribed to them. Plato called the study of number symbolism the highest level of knowledge, while Pythagoras believed numbers had souls as well as magical powers. So, and we all know, you probably have heard of a book called The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, where he asks DeepMind, the most powerful computer in the universe, what is the answer to life, the universe, and everything? And he thinks for a little bit and he comes up with the answer, 42. Okay, well, 42, as it turns out, has been, shall we say, significant in our world for a long time. And I can give you a couple of examples. For example, when I was in Tasmania recently, I picked up randomly this book, and it was about Abel Tasman when he came to Australia, in Tasmania, and he was sailing around the bottom in 1642. It was one of the most significant events as far as expanding the world's knowledge about our planet. And it happened, he went from here and he went to New Zealand, and he took his knowledge back to Europe and shared it, which is the other important thing we've always been able to do, we share knowledge. But it happened in 1642, so there's that number there. 42 appeared probably many times in the past, but there's one example. Another example, and I really like to refer to this man, because in 1942, there was a piece of music written. It was called Fanfare for the Common Man, and it really did, if you like, set us up for what's happening today. And it was written at the beginning of World War II, a time of great stress, and the world's people were coming out of a depression. And in 1942, the vice president, we always try to think of the president as being the most important person, but the vice president of the USA in 1942 wrote something so inspiring that they wrote a piece of music called The Fanfare for the Common Man to celebrate that event. And this is a little bit of what he had to say. The concept of freedom, Wallace explained, was rooted in the Bible, with its extraordinary emphasis on the dignity of the individual, but only recently had it become a reality for large numbers of people. Democracy is the only true political expression of Christianity, he declared, adding that with freedom must come abundance. Men and women can never really be free until they have plenty to eat, and time and the ability to read and think and talk things over. So that's a short excerpt from that speech. But in 1942, a speech was given that really did set us up for the next 100 years. Even though he had no idea, no understanding of what technology would do in the next 100 years. So we haven't made the 100 years yet, I realise that. 1942 is not 100 years, but we're getting close. We're getting pretty close to that. And what he had to say back then really does apply to what's happened today. So my talk today is based on partly numbers, 42, and the chances and opportunities in life we get, and how numbers relate to that, even though there is no direct connection with numbers and events. It just happens that 42 appears a lot, in my case, in my life. For example, if you add my father's birth year and my mother's birth year, 18 and 24, you will get 42. If you look at my telephone numbers, and I didn't choose any of these numbers, by the way. Obviously, I didn't choose the years my mother and father were born. But my telephone numbers, which I did not choose, end in 42. I've got a couple. In 42, even the difference between my wife's age and my age is 42. It's 4 and 2. Her age difference, the year, if you subtract the two, you end up with 42. So there's all these 42s keep appearing, even membership numbers I have. So, correlation, causation, all sorts of things. There is no real connection, but it's just interesting. That's what I find about numbers, just as Pythagoras and people like that thought. So, at the end of the day, why am I here? I'm here because I'm interested in everything. I'm interested in numbers, I'm interested in people, I'm interested in communication. I've spent my working life helping people in remote rural areas, regional areas, get good communications. And to do that, one had to take a lot of risks sometimes. One had to be prepared for nearly anything on any one day. Work in remote areas, you had all sorts of hazards. So to do that, I had to do something else really special that I learned at a very young age. I was taught by my father and siblings how to read. And being able to read, as Henry Wallace said, was the key to the future of our humanity. We needed to be able to read and understand. And this is really fed into what's happening today. The communications world is giving us opportunities we could never have imagined just 50 years ago. When I was growing up, when I started school, I knew how to read before I got to school. And I loved books, I loved words, I loved everything about language. And I was an avid reader from day one. Mainly fiction in those days, cartoons, comics as we called them back then, all that type of thing. So being able to read is one of those fundamentals. And numeracy is the other one. We need to be able to understand numbers at a basic level. We don't have to be experts, we don't have to be mathematicians. All we have to do is be able to have a basic understanding of how the number system works. So, a lot of people got the opportunity to go to university. I didn't. And because in those days, we didn't even have electricity. I was a kid on a farm. We grew bananas, small crops, milk, dairy, cattle, all that sort of thing. We were share farmers. We never owned the farm. We were not wealthy. But as I used to say to people, and I'm going to enter my first acronym here, we were poor because we were paid only on results. That's what poor stands for in our case. And that's pretty much how we were. We were poor people paid only on results. And that acronym rings well with me. But to do anything well, one of the human characteristics, when I develop acronyms, some of these only very recently, a lot of the time when I wake up in the morning, the brain's been busy overnight. And the first thing we have to do is everyone has to smile. So if everyone says the word smile, what will happen? Smile. You will start to smile. One morning I woke up and I thought, smile. So make it look easy. That is the acronym for what I'm here to do. And I'm not an expert, but I'm going to try and make it look easy with a smile. Okay, so then of course we need to, if we're going to talk about things, we need to keep people interested. So one of the things we get to do to make people smile is we add humour. And before I came up with a smile acronym, about 2 months earlier, I woke up one morning and I thought, yeah. And it just entered my head, that co-processor running in the background all night, came up with the answer. As I awoke, it said humour, how you make others understand rapidly. It was so easy, because the brain works when you're asleep. That's part of the development of the human. The brain is an interesting piece of equipment. It's only about 1.5 kilos on average. Might be a bit bigger, a bit smaller, but typically 1.5 kilos. It's about 75% water, so there's only 25% doing the real work. The rest is just keeping it cool, shall we say. But yeah, the brain's a very interesting thing, and it works away whether you're awake or asleep. It's going all the time in the background. And of course, we're starting to really discover that, as we've developed, that we have more than one brain. We have, obviously, the brain we tend to see and look at everything with. and hear and touch, sorry, taste and recognise our senses. But there's a brain in our gut which tells us how to, if you like, it shifts bacteria around to improve our life and make sure that the brain gets the right amount of food, energy, chemicals and things to make it work well. Okay, I'm not a scientist, but guess what? In Queensland we have some amazing brain scientists. We have some in the Queensland Brain Institute, and I read a lot of their work. They produce some amazing publications. And the ability to read allows me to understand what scientists like them have to say. So, apart from that, and I talked about the big wheel before, but a lot of people have this idea that really smart people, if we could just get up and leave planet Earth. Well, I think you might find that that's the 7.6 billion people we've just turned over. That's not going to happen tomorrow. So we have to make plan A, the Earth, work well. So plan B is to make sure that plan A works. Okay? Because we're not leaving planet Earth for a while, I promise you. So we need to get on well with each other. And some really clever people are trying really hard to make that happen. However, at a local level, we have to make it happen here on the ground. We have to be good to each other. We have to be nice to each other. We have to try and share our knowledge and make the world a better place, just even at a local level, because one of the words that drives and underpins all of that is the word love. And the word love is referred to in many documents throughout the world's history. And for me, I came up with an acronym, and it's one that almost fits within those first two, smile and humour. Love to me is to laugh often and value everything. That's what love is to me. So, if we can do that, if we can really be nice to people, then laughing often and valuing everything is how we're going to get on in the world. Okay, what has any of this got to do with communications, bikes, books? It has everything to do. We have to have a love of reading. We have to have a love of knowledge. We have to have a love of other people. And we have to be prepared to share all of that. We have to communicate all of those things. And we have to do it well. And the modern world, the modern wireless communications world that we've entered into, devices like this allow me, with no wires, to connect anywhere in the world and listen to really smart people. I just, this very morning, watched a TED talk. Simon Arnton, I think his name is, but I may stand to be correct on that. But he talks about the best countries in the world. And they're the countries that aren't the happiest countries. They're the countries who deliver the best outcomes for their people in the world. And he gives this the most amazing talk when you listen to it. And you realise that all he wants to do is help people. He just wants to make people's lives better. And he communicates that better than almost anyone I've ever seen. Then we have other people in the world who know, want to use electronic devices in ways which, if you like, goes against the world's best communication technologies. And we've seen some really smart people and leaders of the world say silly things. And we saw it happen very recently. We saw the world come together to rescue some children lost in a cave. They communicated, all speaking different languages. And some kids were lost, and they all worked really hard together. But in the middle of all that, we had a really intelligent person make some crazy comments. And he not only did he make some crazy comments, he put them in writing. And people don't forget those things. So if you like, a lot of his credibility was removed by what he said. So we have to be very careful about what we say to people and how we say it. Now, I know from my own experience I've made a lot of mistakes in my life in saying things without thinking. That's part of my personality. I tend to speak first and think later. A lot of people do. And over time of my life through reading and understanding and studying a little bit about philosophy and thinking a different way, like me, is to think before you speak. And my wife's very good at that. She learns, she has taught me to do that quite often because I've quite often opened my mouth and said words that you can't take back once you've said them. People remember what you said. So, we have to be nice to each other. We have to speak very carefully, and in particular with modern social media, we have to be very careful about what we put in print effectively. We have to, people instantly say things that go right around the world, and one of my favourite authors, Mark Twain, had a saying for this. It was related to it, but basically he said that a lie will travel halfway around the world while the truth is putting its shoes on. And he really nailed it perfectly. What you say travels a long way, and then what you really meant to say comes out later, but it's too late. It's too late for you to take that back. So, I'm going to pause a little bit because I'm going to give people the opportunity to ask a question if they wish to. I'm not, certainly not an expert, I've just met a lot of people and been a lot of places in Australia. So, I'll pause for a moment, I'll have a small drink of water, and if anyone's got any questions so far, I will try and keep my hearing aid up and make sure I hear you correctly. And if you have a question, feel free to ask it. So if you'll forgive me, I'll have a small mouthful of water. Anyone out there with any questions about what I've said so far? Yes, please.
You're really good acronyms. I've missed one. I was running too slow, so I've got four.
Yes.
And what's that?
Paid all your results. Yes.
Yes. And laugh. And there was another one.
Humour was how you make others understand rapidly. And I've got quite a lot. But they're the ones that actually came to me quite recently. The poor one came a long time ago. But acronyms, people, if you like, respond to abbreviations and acronyms. TV's a good one. One of those amazing communications icons that was introduced to Australia about the time that I was born, in 57. TV stands for television. So acronyms and abbreviations are commonplace in the world today. I spent my whole life in the technical world understanding abbreviations, and I'm sure in the legal world and the medical world and all the other worlds, abbreviations are a part of language. So if I say to someone they're DOA, you all pretty much know what that means if you're in the hospital. The ambulance takes someone to hospital, and so that's not a good one, I realise, but they all know what it means. They all know what it means. And also, and what I like to do is I like to convert some of the crazy ones we've had, which we all grew up and we all understood what we would call offensive language. And that is, words that aren't pleasant for us to say in public, and we shouldn't say them. And we all know common ones typically have letters that mean something else immediately in the brain, but we can create better ones, is what I say. Better acronyms, better language to express our frustration with the world. And, TFIF for me is thankfully it's Friday. So I used to have a performance feedback management system, And basically, PMFS, and basically, please make fun systematically, or something like that. I tried to turn it into something that was interesting to me. I never liked them, so I tried to turn abbreviations into things that would cheer me up, if anything, and let me get over the negativity I felt. So by using words smartly, we can cheer other people up, we can make them feel more comfortable with their surroundings, more happy with the work that they're doing. We can really get to understand how other people think. But the moment we start using offensive language and everything else, we start putting people off. And we've seen how the president recently referring to someone as Rocket Man is a good example. Now, that's not particularly offensive, but when you start calling people names, and we used to have a name for this at school, a little rhyme for this at school, sticks and stones can break my bones, but words will never hurt me. The trouble is, if you say these words to parents, powerful people and they get offended, these people are in a position where they might do something silly. So we really need to not say things if we don't mean them. And if we do mean them, say them in a nice way. So, and this is one of the difficult parts of management, dealing with people like me, because I get frustrated easily, and around budget cuts and resource limitations and trying to get the job done. But if you start restricting me in any way, I start to get a little bit upset. So then I come out with poor language. So a good example I'm going to give you is something I come up with. I'm going to wake the screen up at last. And I created something about 20 years ago. Our legal team turned up, and one of my jobs was a regulatory function. And we were poorly trained for that, in my opinion. So we had to, if you like, think on the fly. So I'm just going to bring that up on the screen. So I created something way back then that really helped me with that. Okay, hopefully I get the screen up and running. Screen mirroring. Okay. I created this. We can make it a bit bigger, hopefully. Just one again. That's better. I come up with the triangle of failure. Now, the good news is, every time we get something wrong, I see opportunity. So, people might see that as a negative thing, the triangle is actually one of the strongest geometric shapes there is. And the legal team thought that was okay, they took that away with them, and I gave them that because after listening to all their talks and all of their lessons in how to deal with people in a regulatory sense, I came up with a simple reason why people don't do the right thing. Not because they're bad people. In most cases, they don't know the rules. They've never read them. They're expected to know. We have laws where people are expected to know. But in many cases, they don't understand how to apply those rules and how to make them fit with the legislation. So that was something I came up with 20 years ago. And interestingly enough, I read a book by Rachel Robertson, and she's an amazing woman who took on the old workforce from, I think, Victorian Parks and Wildlife, and she tried to change a lot of the way things were happening. And she came up with triangles as well. But her triangles were all about not allowing people, not listening to hearsay, not listening to rumours, but in other words, don't let someone get between you and the other person. Don't let the triangle get in your way. And I've read her website. She's a very smart person, wrote a very good book. She gives public speeches. But all she talks about is triangles. But I'm a solutions person. I don't see problems, I only see solutions. Because that's the training I had as a technician. And I'll give you another acronym. When I was, as a technician, I was taught some fundamentals. My job was to breathe air into any situation. I assessed, I identified, and I resolved. I assessed the problem, I identified solutions, and I applied the solutions. Assess, identify, resolve. Air, I breathed air into any situation. The other one, sometimes I had to do a bit more. I had to do CPR. And when I had to do CPR, I had to compare, prepare, and repair. So I'd breathe air in, I'd do CPR. And I would, at the end of the day, give an answer which was acceptable. Sometimes it was not the complete answer. It required more engineering input. But on the day, those people had a working communication service. And that's where I started working. So, breathing air into a situation, doing CPR, was how I was trained. I was trained to do this. I was trained, as I said to Louise earlier, to say yes. And when Louise was offered to, suggestion that I do a talk, I was trained to say yes, even before I come up with the answer. So that is why I tend to say yes more than no. So, I had a Spanish friend, a very good friend of mine, and he said, why do you always say yes? and in his Spanish accent, which I really liked. And I thought about it for a moment, and I said, well, because people don't, if you start a sentence with the word no, people automatically put a wall up. This is a communication skill. If you say no to somebody, the wall goes up, and all the next six textbooks you say, the wall is up. They don't hear anything. The hearing aid is off. They take the battery out, they turn it off, and they put earplugs in because you've said no. So I learned to say yes. And he said, okay, I want free beer. And I said, yes, but not today. So, by learning to say yes, even if you're going to give a negative answer, you hopefully appease the person you're saying you're really going to say no to, but say yes in a nice way. Say no, I should say, in a nice way, by saying yes first. So I learned to say yes because it was the best way to deal with the public and to give them the outcome they were hoping for. And quite often, all they wanted was somebody to talk to. All they wanted was somebody who would acknowledge that they had a problem in many cases. We had a situation, and this was written back in the 40s, could have even been 42, where people were asked, what sort would they like, a telephone that works some of the time, or a telephone that works all of the time? Remember that big wheel? Now we've got the NBN. You can have the NBN that works some of the time, and the NBN that works all the time. Has anything? That big wheel just keeps going back, doesn't it? So it really is, life is that circular type of thing. So, communicating with people, yeah, I breathe air into situations, and I try very hard to do CPR if just bringing air in doesn't solve the problem, and if that doesn't solve it, then I usually get advice, obviously, that I've done my best, I'm not good enough. So, the triangle of failure, I come up with a reason to fix that. And for a long time I thought about the F word in the middle, failure. Why was I failing? I was failing because I wasn't focused. And of course, the answer came to me immediately. We needed something else. If you put four triangles together, and I haven't done the graphics for this, but I'm quite lazy. If you put the F and then you put another triangle here that matches it, and then you put another one at the top, and you put another one to the side, the next one is the letter R. We need to be focused, we need to be responsive to people's problems. This is called, by the way, my geometry of the mind. We need to be E, experienced, and we need to be, the last one, decisive. So the four triangles, the letters of the four triangles, if you put them all together, make a square. And what we end up with is the square of success. The square of success is to be focused, responsive, educated, and decisive. So, now, I'm not satisfied even with that, because I love geometry, I love shapes. Brain loves those types of things. I like what I see. So what happens when we do that? When we live a world where we're focused, responsive, educated, and decisive. And by the way, I'm going to send all this to Rachel now that I've read her book, her excellent book, and let her know how I've expanded the triangle issue. At the end, what fits, what covers the square? We can put a square inside a circle. And we end up with the circle of satisfaction. We want to be satisfied that what we've done, we've defeated failure. We've changed F from failure to focus. We've added more elements. We've made the square of success. We're focused, we're responsive, we're educated, the ability to read and get that information out there. And we're decisive. When we know the answer, we need to apply it. And we need to make sure that people who are waiting for us to apply our knowledge, a doctor or a technician or a plumber or a tradie, is not going to do anything if he focuses on a triangle. He's only going to get the job done, he or she, I should say. They're only going to get the job done if they're focused, responsive, educated, and decisive. And then the circle of satisfaction appears, both for both parties, both the person who does the work and the person who is the recipient of the work. Everyone is happy. So, we all want to make other people happy. We all want that smile to occur in our life. We all want to laugh often and value everything. So, a good example just in how we should do things in life. So, you've got, and I know a lot of people will be doing this already. We're in traffic. Someone is desperately trying to get their car in between your car and the car in front. I know personally what happens for me when I decide to stop and allow someone in, or even one or two, I start feeling really, really good. The true recipient of love and happiness is the giver, not the person who has received the gift. So, thinking about how we do things, making sure that people understand our intentions, that we are educated and quite decisive in what we do. So decide to do good things in your life, do good things. And there's some really good speakers on TED who are, I played one this morning, Simon Hamstrung, I think it is. It's all about good countries. And he used data, a lot of data, to figure out the best country in the world. And there's actually a chart. You can go to goodcountry.org, I think it is. And he gives one of the best speeches on how to do good things to make the world a better place I have ever seen. Made me feel good just watching him. Just watching that man deliver that talk, I felt so good. So he made someone he doesn't know on the other side of the world, that big wheel, he's no idea that I exist. And yet he can do it. So moving on from that, I did a lot of research into hubs. And I'm just wondering how we're going. We'll have some question time in a moment, but I'm going to bring it to a little bit of a close. I did some works on hubs, and like everything, I tend to bring everything, I practice reductionism. I bring everything down to a smaller amount of information, and I found these words. And this was from shareable.net, and they have three cities in Australia that use it. This is no time for mere resistance, nor is it a time for blame, resignation, or sharpening our differences. It is a time for bold new visions. It is a time to reach across boundaries, identify common needs, and work together to meet them directly where we live. It is time for pragmatic solutions by the people. It's time for human beings to go on new, creative adventures together, as if our lives depended on it, because they do. And there, I could never have written it that well. It literally is a couple of sentences, but and that's from shareable.net. They've asked that it's a Creative Commons license. They've asked that we say where did that information come from, so I've done that. And a couple of other really good quotes. Buckminster Fuller, who was a great inspiration to me. You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. And that's what we've done. For the first time in history, I can sit in the river and watch a video or learn about something to do with any piece of knowledge the human race has developed. I can be anywhere. Wireless communications has allowed this to happen, and my entire working career, apart from their very initial training, has been in wireless communications. So, and mobile phones, who thinks they're new? Well, I can tell you in the 60s, we had mobile phones in Australia. They were a box that were in a car, and they had an antenna, and they had a direct line dedicated to each one. And this is in the days before computers came along. So mobile phones are not new. They've been around for a long time. Wireless communications, wireless telephony has been around for a very long time. The other thing is that very quickly, I wanted to address where I come from. So I always, as a left-handed person, I always start at the end and finish at the beginning. And I come from a place in New South Wales called the Woolloombah, the Tweed River. It's an interesting place. Its indigenous name is Woolloomba, the cloud catcher, and I now live. I am the cloud catcher, more than 60 years later. But I share my birthplace with two Queenslanders. George England. I was born in Wollombar in 1895 and was educated in Wollombar Public School, where I was educated in my high school years. And in the year that I was born, on the 3rd of August 1957, he became the Premier of Queensland. So he came from the same place that I did. So Queenslanders had a Premier who was born in the same place as I was, a little village. So it takes a village to raise a child. So the second one, and this one was a little bit, not so much controversial, but he lived at a controversial time. Sir Walter Benjamin Campbell, QC, was born just around the corner from where I was born, on the same day as my eldest son. Remember I said about numbers and how they tend to all come back? In 1921, his mother, like mine, died unexpectedly, leaving Walter and his brothers to spend a considerable amount of time with his mother's parents. So he was raised by the village, by his grandmother, uncles, aunties, like I was. I was raised by the village. I'm a child of the village, and I'm still wondering what I'm going to do when I grow up. Okay. And one other, and his main event that we all remember was he was the Governor General when, during the period of turmoil in Queensland, when J.B. Orkney-Peterson was forced to give up government. Well, he was born just around the corner from me, probably 5 or 6 kilometres away. Not at the same time, obviously, in 1921. And the one other thing, we see them driving around all day, J.J. Richards, and their innovation of side-loading garbage trucks and all of that stuff, which was taken up by German USA companies, all came from Wollombar, where I was born. So that's the third and final one. So I'm going to quieten down a little bit, have another drink of water, and hopefully I've said a few interesting things, and you may be interested in asking a question, which hopefully I can do CPR. I did have a couple of other props, but I shall take questions first. Yes?
You said that we need to learn to say yes.
Yes.
How do you teach your child to say yes?
How do I?
Teach your child to say yes.
Teach your child to say yes.
And he always start with saying no. How can you?
It's the first word you learn as a child. Mm-hmm. In fact, I had a good manager once who said to me, he was a commander of submarines, and he was a very disciplined and well-educated man, much more better educated than I was. And we had a meeting, and he was our new manager, and he said, "I've never told a lie." And I smiled, and I said, "Gee, that's the second one today." So, because all children, the first thing we do is we learn to lie, because we want our parents to be happy and we don't want them to know we've been naughty, right? We learn to lie, first thing we do. So, we want to please the other person. So how do you teach a child to say yes? That's a combination of fair and reasonable discipline. And in my day, I was a left-hander and they tried very hard. They hit me over the head with a padlock and keys from the sports room and a ruler whenever I tried to write left-handed. So in those days, you were disciplined very heavily. Fortunately, I grew out of that and that he stopped doing it after a little chat from my father. And that doesn't mean I didn't get into trouble, but we'd learn to say yes because we want to please our parents, but to teach someone how to say yes, all we can do is, and we didn't put it on, and there is from Mahatma Gandhi, we have to be the person that we want to be. So we have to demonstrate to them. That's how they will learn. So that is the answer. So off the cuff, if you ask me tomorrow, I might have a different answer, but off the cuff, I think that's how I would do it. Yeah. So is that reasonable?
Yes. Yes. So usually, we need to learn to say yes.
Yes.
Right. So, how can you say yes to your child all the time? Because you need to lead by example, right?
Yes.
So if your child say, "Mom, I need a phone."
An iPad.
And you say yes.
Well, I'll tell you what I did with our children. I said, "You can use mine." you really, really need a phone. So I'll give a practical example of what I did. Because mobile phones were very expensive back in the 90s. And so with my kids, I said, look, we've got a mobile phone. If you really need one, then you can use mine. Yeah, so share those good characteristics. Teach sharing. Teach knowing. Teach how to be good people. And then I think the child will learn by themselves, because children are very smart. Children are very smart. They learn much faster than adults.
So I think discipline to be in that too.
Sorry?
I think discipline to be in that, because, what are you, 61 now?
I'm 61 this year.
Same here. And when we were brought up, if you asked for something and it was no, you knew it was no. They didn't have, parents didn't have to go no because of. If they said no, you knew there was a reason for it. So I think it's the vintage, the era, whatever you want to call it, discipline and instruction, and also a lot of respect.
You
broke the boundary?
Yep. And I'll give you one final example of that. When I was 5 years old, the same teacher that used to hit me, and he was a good teacher, he wasn't a bad person, he was a very good teacher, he used to hit me over the knuckles and the head with the pain on his head. I have another kindergarten child who used to walk home, it was about 4 kilometres on a dirt road. And cigarette packets were big in those days, they had gold and silver paper. And as a child, we loved those. Yeah, and bright and shiny, kids like bright and shiny. So we were picking them up, and he told us to stop. So we threw them down and walked on. They were just throwing us on the road. And after that, the next day, the very next day, guess what? Did we listen? No. He was there picking cigarette packets up and getting the gold and silver paper out. The next day, he caught us the second time in a row. Right? Two strikes. The third one, there was no third one. The next day, he unraveled a hoop, cane hoop, a thin one, a little one. And both her and I, with a gender equality back then, we both got away. And we never did it again. So I'm not saying it's the right answer. I'm just saying that's my opinion.
I think if you're going to say no, you can justify why you're saying no. You very, very rarely get somebody pushing issue. If you say no, and that's going to be quite common, justify why.
Yes.
What we're talking to in regards to triangles. If you look at triangles, if you take one side away, you don't have the other two.
Yes.
Where you had your failure, if you take any of them, one of the three out, the other two won't be.
And that's what Rachel Robertson does.
Yeah.
She takes one side away. She takes something away, I add. So we have different ways of approaching the same.
In the welding industry, it's called a combustion triangle.
Hmm.
That's it. If you don't obey those three, you'll have a fire. And simply, ignition, oxygen, and material. So if you have a workshop where someone has normally kept clean, but one day the material is left there, there's a grinder and a spark, you've now got the three sides. If you take one side out and don't have the rubbish, you don't have the issue.
Well,
it's fairly simple with triangles.
Yes, that is true. And I just very, very quickly, I picked these up. A lot of things in my life happen very randomly. I make no plans. And these magazines just appeared on the side of the road at a charity event. And the Surgeon General of the United States said these words. And like I said, I can't write them any better than this man. And he was the past Surgeon General. He said, "I am deeply concerned about the level of stress that our country is experiencing. I think it's preventing us from achieving our full potential. I have long believed there are fundamentally, and I use the word fundamentals a lot in my talk, two forces or emotions that drive our decisions, both love and fear. Love has its many manifestations, compassion, gratitude, I'm big on gratitude, kindness and joy. Fear often manifests in cynicism, anger, jealousy and anxiety. I worry that many of our communities are being driven by fear, and it's partly because of the things we read about in the news that give us pause about the state of the world." So, those words, I followed a thinker, a great thinker in Europe, called Rolf Dobelli, and he wrote a large essay on stop watching the news. And I now practice that as much as possible. And I I do see the news, obviously, you see headlines and things like that. You do see the news, you're not totally immune from it, but I try very hard, and we normally do not watch the news at home. Or even on the radio, I try and switch something else on rather than the news. So, fear is what's keeping us from our potential, full potential, I believe. We need to eliminate things that are causing us to fear everything. Someone's going to, you know, send a nuclear weapon up, or someone's going to do something bad, or a new disease is going to appear, or whatever. We need to challenge fear, and we need to overcome it with love. We need to laugh off and value everything, but we need to do our best to, yeah, only have good news. Only have good news.
All your learners to listen to it, take in what you want.
Yeah, and ignore the bad stuff. So, and two great, I reckon we should have a good news channel. Two great bits of good news that you should have.
Yeah. So there's a really important reason why we don't have a good news channel, and this is what's a bit sad. Good news doesn't sell. And so the news that we read isn't the news, it's the news that is most emotional, provoking, and therefore will sell advertising. So it's not real news anyway. There's no point watching the news.
So well, on my Twitter page you'll see a picture of a woman lying on the concrete with a bit of rag around her, sleeping homeless. Well, I'll tell you two bits of good news in the last 2 weeks. In Melbourne and Sydney, they both opened up old nursing homes that were just scheduled for demolition to get dozens of older women who had nowhere to live off the street, who were sleeping on the street. So that's the good news I want to hear.
That's good.
So there is good news. It is newsworthy. We just have to try and, yes?
First of all, thank you for sharing your personal thoughts for your mom. Just one comment about the predicament of saying no, but just a comment that now we seem to be living in the world of entitlement.
Yes,
anyone that's born in the 21st century has that view on things, and you know, they think that they need it now. They need it, but they need it now. Instant gratification, all that sort of thing. But
yes,
we're having to deal with the current generation of children.
Yes, well, we live in a world where, yes, that is a big problem. Obesity and diet and all those types of things are happening because of...
And I blame technology in a way, because technology kids seem to get conditioned with this sort of instant gratification, and they can get it through technology and the internet.
Yeah, I was trying to give that way of keeping their ears open. If you say no, I've seen it time and time again in my work situations, many people, as a regulator in particular, where I had to read the rules to people. If you say no to anyone, their ears close. They stop listening to your message. So what you have to do is, you're still saying no. I'm not saying no. I'm saying you have to phrase it in a way that is conciliatory and communicate the idea that you want to help that person. As someone said to me once, as a regulator, you're here to issue fines. I said, no. I'm here to prevent you from doing something that will cause someone to issue a fine. I'm here to save you, to stop you from doing something. I said to you, and to give you the best options. So the last thing I'll ever want to do is use the sanction to make you comply with the law. I want to do it persuasively 99 times out of 100 if I can.
Last question. No more questions? Excellent. Thank you, Brad. Brian, thank you very much. I would like to echo those sentiments. Thank you very much for sharing your philosophy in life. I really like the love acronym. Love often and value everything. That's excellent. So we value you today.
Thank you very much.